welcome the Lord here this morning.
Amen.
Just lift your hands up to the Lord. Lord, we are here to worship. We are here to worship you, Lord. Anybody here to worship the Lord? Would you just raise your hands up high to the Lord? I'm here for you. I am here for you. I'm not here just because of religion or tradition. I'm not just here because that's what you do Sunday morning. I'm here, God, to give you my praise, Lord. As we sing, here I am, and here I am to worship. Lift your voice.
Here I am to bow down,
and here I am.
See you.
can be saved.
Pray with me. God, we thank you that you gave your life so clearly, so powerfully, so knowingly, Lord, that we might have eternal life in you. We thank you, God, that you gather us this morning desiring to save us, desiring to grant meaning and power and purpose in our lives, if only we would let go of our feeble attempts to be you. God, we ask that this morning, as we begin this Holy Week journey, that you would speak clearly, that you would pull back the curtains that continue to cover our eyes and keep us from real relationship with you. I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be your word for us today. And we'll be faithful and grateful to humble ourselves before you, giving you the glory and the honor and the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. So many of you know that we have been following a sermon series focused on invitation and evangelism, focused on the power of relationships to draw people into a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. But today I want us to talk about a different kind of evangelism. I want us to consider that the very story of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection is magnetic unto itself. And that if you and I internalize the power of the witness of Jesus the Christ, that as we know the story better, we will live it, and in our living the story, others will be drawn to the Jesus in us. Touch your neighbor and say, the story is magnetic. The very story of Jesus' life is a story of redemption and a story of God's power. And I believe that one of the most powerful parts of the story that God is telling is that God gave it all. Touch somebody else and say, he gave it all. God gave everything he had and knowingly walked to his own death that you and I might have life. And I believe that one of the great gaping holes in our hearts today as people is a search for meaning and purpose. A place in which we live in the midst of luxury and a thousand things that make our lives better and faster and easier. And yet, we end up scrolling through our phones, isolated daily by the hurriedness and the demands around us. And instead of feeling freed, we go to bed at night wondering what it's all about. Wondering what the real meaning is. How many people in the world around us wouldn't give everything they had to know that there was something worth living and dying for? There was recently a story that was being told of an older woman who was diagnosed with cancer. Instead of going the traditional route of chemotherapy and all kinds of treatment, she decided, I'm not doing anything. I am taking the remaining 3 to 4 months of my life, and I am going to live with purpose and meaning in a way that I never have. And she traveled the country, and her family went with her, and she spent the last days of her life with an intentionality and a purposefulness in what she saw, in what she did, and who she poured her life into. What if we lived as those prepared to die all the time? What if those questions of meaning and purpose were questions that we intentionally wrestled with today so that we could spend every moment we have bearing witness to who Christ is? In your sermon outline, you'll see the story of a doctor who works at Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York City. And he specializes in end-of-life care for those who are terminally ill. And he was troubled by the trend that he saw in this country where many more people started engaging assisted suicide. And he started to ask himself, what is it that terminal patients lose that leads them to the place of asking for assisted death? And as he studied and engaged with his patients, he found that there were 3 things that were most important for people wanting to live. The first was they needed to feel that their existence was valued by others. Second, they needed to be driven by a sense of purpose or an important life goal. And third, they needed to understand that their lives were coherent and part of an integrated plan. Now, as your pastor, I look at all of that and I say, our faith in Jesus Christ answers every one of those questions. By the work of Christ in you, you have value to those around you, not only for what you can share, but how you can be Christ to them. And because of the saving work of God in your life and in mine, we live for a bigger purpose than just the details of everyday life. Psychologist and philosopher said that the path to meaning lies in connecting and contributing to something that is bigger than yourself, like family or country or God. Raise your hand if you want to be part of something bigger. We all do. And our faith affords us that opportunity. The story of Jesus' life is evangelical in itself. The ability of Christ's self-willing decision to put himself on the cross points to a purpose that God gives us beyond any other. The third scripture for today comes from Philippians 2, starting with verse 5. And I invite you to open your Bibles to that. If you're using a pew Bible, it's page 197. Philippians 2, starting at verse 5. And listen to these words. Say amen if you're ready. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. You see all that purpose in there? You see all that intentionality? You see all the way in which God makes choices and invites us to follow? Therefore, God so highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Christ lost his life to save ours. Like Luke 9:23 that says, if any man would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life would lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. I want us to look deeper at this Palm Sunday story so that we can understand how it is that God is calling us to give it all. I want you to open in your sermon outlines to the maps that you have there. Say amen when you've got your maps open. And there's a couple of things that I want you to know about this Palm Sunday descent that Jesus makes. If you look at that first box there, on the far right-hand side is the Mount of Olives, 400 feet above sea level, and you can see the slope that leads down to the Kidron Valley. Jesus did not walk a straight, flat entrance into Jerusalem. He stood on the top of the Mount of Olives and literally descended into the Kidron Valley, knowing that he was descending to what would be his death. If you look at the second drawing there, you see that the Mount of Olives is on its eastern side. There is Bethphage and Bethany. And Jesus had just come from Bethany. Anybody know what he did in Bethany before he went down the Palm Sunday journey? He did something very important at Bethany. He raised Lazarus from the dead. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead in Bethany, walked one Sabbath day's journey to Bethphage at the very top of the Mount of Olives, sends his disciples to go and find a colt, and begins this descent down. Now that second picture you have at the bottom of the page, you see what's in there? They look like stone boxes. Anyone know what those are? Those are Jewish tombs. The Mount of Olives is also called Resurrection Hill because there are thousands and thousands of Orthodox Jewish graves that are there on the Mount of Olives, intentionally placed there because the Orthodox Jews, like the now Christians, believe that Jesus will come again through the east gate of the old city, which is right there in front of the Mount of Olives. So don't miss the symbolism. Jesus is descending into his death, walking through the valleys of life, but in every way possible, he is speaking about resurrection and hope. He has just raised Lazarus from the dead, and he's descending a hill that is littered with thousands of graves of those who wait to be the first who will be raised when the Messiah comes. The other piece that's important about Jesus' descent down the Mount of Olives is that from the top of the Mount of Olives, you have a direct line of sight of the Temple Mount. The Temple Mount is Mount Moriah, where Abraham was called to rise up and sacrifice his son Isaac, but God provided a lamb in the thicket. Jesus is looking at Mount Moriah. On top of Mount Moriah is where King Solomon built the first temple. It is also the place that the second temple was built and then razed by the Romans. Now it is the Dome of the Rock, a Muslim shrine. It is also where the Wailing Wall is. Jesus entered Jerusalem, knowing he was facing death, but in every way possible, surrounded himself with signs of resurrection. And the Mount of Olives is the place where people were waiting to be raised. What if in every valley of your life, you gave it all? You walked down knowing it would be hard, but that you were doing the will of God, and in so walking, you bear hope and sight of the power of resurrection. If you turn the page, the second thing that is powerful about Jesus' Palm Sunday journey is that he does not descend this Palm Sunday walk on a war horse. He intentionally chooses a colt, a sign of peace. And the people around him are Jewish, and they understand the prophecy that he is fulfilling. In Zechariah 9, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. Humble and riding on an ass, on a colt, the foal of an ass. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall command peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." Some 450 to 500 years prior to Jesus' arrival, the prophet prophesied this very event, and the powerful thing is the people get it. They know what is happening, which is why they raise their voices and say, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Jesus, in addition to descending to his death surrounded by resurrection, is proclaiming that strength comes through peace and self-sacrifice. Think about your own faith journey. How many times have you wanted to take it into your own hands, to force something that you wanted to happen immediately? To show that you had the power or the authority or the ability, as opposed to choosing a colt to enter your own death, giving it all that Christ would rise within you. What if we were to live the Palm Sunday story? The last thing I want you to think about as we talk about self-sacrifice: Jesus walked down that road looking at Mount Moriah. He knew what Abraham had been called to do. He knew about his call to sacrifice Isaac. And he knew that God had provided. What if we were willing to give it all, believing that even when we can't yet see, God will make provision. God will use the fullness of what we give. The third thing I want you to consider, and I never paid attention to this at all, on that Mount of Olives, that is the very place that Jesus ascended to heaven. Those darkest valleys in your life, the places where you are sure that you have been defeated, the moments that you thought you were walking to your own death, may be the very moments God uses to exalt you. The place where you descend may be the very place he brings you back to ascend. Jesus ascended into heaven on the Mount of Olives, in full view of the Temple Mount, in full view of all of these tombs, of those awaiting resurrection, knowing that he was back at the very place he had walked to his death. Jesus ascended into heaven from the Mount of Olives. What if in your giving it all, your defeat is actually your place of victory? What if the story isn't done yet? The final piece I offer to you about Palm Sunday is that there is prophecy about Christ coming again. We say it in our communion liturgy, right? Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And part of the prophetic sense is that Jesus will return, and in that returning, there is a new kind of Palm Sunday. If you look in your sermon outline, Revelation 7, 9 to 10, I looked and behold a great multitude which no man could number from every nation, all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white with what in their hands? What are in their hands? Palm branches, crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb." Before I close, I want you to watch a brief video clip from a teacher in Israel, and you will get to see he is standing on the Mount of Olives, looking out over the old city of Jerusalem. And there, as he is looking by the Temple Mount, is also the East Gate. Christian prophecy says that Christ will come again through that east gate. It is currently walled up because a Muslim ruler heard that the Messiah was to come through there, and it was built up. But Christ will break it down. I invite you to look at the power of the site of the Mount of Olives.
One of the things that I love about this beautiful site is it gives you such a magnificent
You're
view
riding on a donkey
of
on
the old
day of
city
this triumphal entry.
The Kidron Valley was filled with thousands of people who had heard about his resurrection of Lazarus. They were waving palm branches as a sign of adoration, and they were crying out, "Hosanna to the Son of David," meaning Messiah, save us. But within a few days, that same crowd was screaming, "Crucify him, crucify him." You know, folks, the scriptures tell us that one day, very soon, Jesus is going to be returning to this mountain. He's going to be returning this next time, not on a humble donkey, but he's going to be returning on a white war charger, the symbol of a victorious general. And once again, that valley is going to be filled with people, hundreds of millions of glorified saints with angels above. And he is going to ride down into that valley again on that white war charger. And once again, the redeemed saints will cry out, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David," as he rides up to that eastern gate. Psalm 24 tells us that as the Messiah, Jesus, approaches that eastern gate, that it will blow open supernaturally to welcome him into the city. Here's how it's described in the Hebrew Scriptures in Psalm 24, beginning with verse 7. "Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, that the King of glory shall come in." And who is the King of glory? "The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift up your everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." And who is the King of glory? "The Lord of hosts," he is the King of glory. Jesus will then enter the Temple Mount, where he will be coronated the King of kings and the Lord of lords, and will begin his millennial reign over all the earth. Oh my, what a day that will be. There's a garden over here adjacent to the chapel, and I'd like to show you something very special there. One of the things that I love about this beautiful site is it gives you such a magnificent view of the old city of Jerusalem.
In closing, I invite you to consider that Palm Sunday is the story of a God who gives it all, who willingly, knowingly walks to his death, surrounded by all kinds of signs of resurrection. A God who gives his life for you and for me, and in the place of defeat, returns to be lifted up in the fullness of his glory, the place where he will come again, the place where Christ will come to judge the nations, the place where God will continue to act in history. I invite you to engage the question of meaning in your life head on. Do you know the bigger purpose for which you're living? Do you know what you're willing to give it all for? Do you know what Christ is calling in you? If Christ is not the very center of the fullness of your life giving, I invite you to make him that. And watch how day by day he changes you. The more you give Christ, the deeper meaning you will find in your life, and the more others will see that work in you. You need to lose your life to save it. You need to let go and surrender that he might be God. You need to walk into the valley, believing that there are signs of resurrection all around you. You need to hold on to God's word of power, even in the hard chapters of your life. And you and I need to proclaim that God is not done yet. God is not done with Syria. God is not done with the United States. God is not done with race relations in this country. God is not done with gender equity. God is not done with this church. God is not done with us, but we got to walk giving it all, that in that giving, Christ would save us from ourselves. Will you pray with me? God, we are grateful that you were so purposeful about everything you did that day. The way that you told us a story of hope even in the midst of death. We're grateful, God, that you're not done with our lives and that you can take brokenness, and when we give it to you, you give us meaning and purpose and power and calling. Lord, in all the lonely places of our lives, the places we don't know if it's worth it, the places we aren't even sure how to give over, take us, God. Take us fully, that you might live in us and we might draw others to you by your Spirit in us. Use us, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, it might look like a downtrodden place to raise hope and there is peace and there is joy.